Greetings and welcome to another edition of The Pedalshift Project. The Pedalshift Project is a series of conversations, thoughts, and experiments around the bike touring lifestyle. From tips and tricks to ideas on how to ride your ride, let's shrink the world by bike. Show notes and more are at pedalshift.net/183, and you can email the show, pedalshift@pedalshift.net, or call the voicemail hotline at 202-930-1109, and check Pedalshift out on all the socials as well. Hello, everybody, and welcome to another thrilling installment of the Pedalshift Project. I feel like I'm overselling it a bit there, but it is a good show. I'm Tim Mooney, your humble host here, and I'm super excited because this is the first episode of November. November is sort of a fun month. It's typically, for me, the final real good month of bicycle touring that I have in a season. But as we'll be talking over the next several weeks, that may not be necessarily happening. There may be more on the horizon as we go into winter, and we'll talk much more about that in future shows. I do want to mention one big thing coming later this fall is the last Pedalshift Live of 2019. It is coming December 7th at 3 p.m. Eastern Time. That is a Saturday, by the way. You have spoken through your votes. That was the by the barest, slimmest of majorities, the Saturday date worked out. So we will be chatting Saturday afternoon if you're on the East Coast of the United States. Otherwise, wherever you're at, check your curvature of the Earth time zone thingy, December 7th, 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Another thing that's going to be coming a little bit more proximate to that, it's the annual Thanksgiving show, and it drops in a few weeks, and there is still time to get your input into the show. What are you thankful for in the realm of bicycle touring? Call the voicemail hotline, add your voice to things, take a minute, tell everyone what you're thankful for. Be anonymous if you'd like. Also, you can email in the thoughts or hit me up in social media with all of them. It would be really, really awesome to get as many people as possible to chime in about what you're thankful for in bicycle touring. You may have heard in past years, if you've been with a show for a while, that I did the old Ride on the C&O show that I've replayed for a bunch of years. But I think what I'd like to do is get more folks involved and to hear your voices, or at least read your voices if you email in. So if you can get that into me by November 20th, that would be fantastic. That's kind of my deadline for doing that show. And that, of course, will be dropping on American Thanksgiving Day that Thursday morning, 7 a.m., just like always. On this episode of the show, we are going to check in again with bicycle touring with dogs revisited. And the reason is that most of my touring over the last several weeks has involved riding with Belle Starr. And I actually recorded an entire episode on the C&O that I was originally going to be using for this episode. But unfortunately, this was the last several, we'll call it the last few weeks of my former phone. And for whatever reason, the audio recording was kind of garbage. So you're stuck with me in the condo with the usual microphone setup. I suppose it sounds better on this microphone, but it's always more fun to take you along for a ride. But I thought that I would just take a few minutes and go through all of the various things that I think are important to keep in mind if you're intending on bicycle touring with a dog. Interestingly, I think that the parallels for touring with kids are kind of, well, parallel, similar. So if you don't have a dog and maybe you're not even considering touring with another creature whatsoever, but you are maybe thinking of going with small kids or somebody else that needs a little bit more caretaking, I think a lot of this stuff is pretty parallel. So why don't we just jump right in? I think that my take on touring with Belle in particular, but dogs generally, they've evolved. My sense on things has evolved a little bit. I think a few things I've definitely kept the same over time, but some of that has involved some evolution, and I'll get into that too. Number one, keep your mileage expectations low. When I first started wanting to tour with Louis, I think mistakenly that Louis and Belle, since I've been riding with her, represented just additional weight. and maybe depending on the scenario of how I've been carrying them, a modification in how I carried that weight. And what I found pretty quickly is, yes, the weight matters. It matters quite a bit. But also just how I'm riding, fatigue, things like that, stopping for breaks for my dogs, that matters. And that, I think, eats into the possibility of making the same type of mileage that you're ordinarily used to making. When I took Belle Starr out intending to do the entire C&O, I think this was a couple of summers ago or maybe a couple of falls ago. Definitely 2 years ago. I was sort of stunned that I couldn't make the same miles that I was used to doing. By that time in the fall, my recollection is that I was, riding very strong, and I thought, I can bang out 60 miles on the C&O without a problem. And I think without her, I very much could have. But what I found was after the first night when I was riding into Hancock, as memory serves. So this is I was riding from west to east. I took the train out with her. I found that I was just crushed at the end of the day, just really, really tired. And part of it was just that, you're fighting a lot more weight. You're dealing with a lot more things. And of course, mentally, I was a lot more checked out compared to just focusing on the ride like I normally did, because I was focused on so many other things. And there were a variety of other factors that were involved with that particular ride. But what I found is that because I ended up calling the ride early later on down the road, or the trail, actually, for another completely different reason, I was like, man, I really would have liked to have done that trail in 4 days or maybe even 5 days with her. Longer tour, right? But B, I think it just would have been more enjoyable. I think that by the end of the second day, I hadn't even gotten all the way to Harper's Ferry. And I was just done. I was really checked out, really mentally exhausted, and ended up having to call the tour there. So that was a big lesson for me, to keep the mileage expectations low. Now when I've been taking her out, and I missed taking her out completely last year just because weather conditions just didn't cooperate, I've been just doing these kind of 15, 20 mile days with her, and it's fantastic. Now, I think that I would prefer to do a longer ride with her, and I can, I think, but I don't think I would ever do anything more than maybe 40 miles. I think 2/3 of my usual kind of 60 mile day, which would be math, 40 miles, I think is the perfect type of thing for me on that trail. If I was on pavement, maybe it would be different. If I was on a gap, maybe I would do more miles. I don't know, but point being, keeping those mileage expectations low just makes for a lot better riding and a lot better experience with your pooch. Number two, rethink your priorities. Everything gets knocked down a few notches to make the comfort and safety of your dog the top two slots. I guess if I sit here and think about it, when I'm out on a regular bike tour, I suppose safety is probably my number one thing for me when I'm alone. But when I'm caring for my dog, well, she's number one. Everything about comfort and safety for me goes by the wayside. It's comfort and safety for her first. So as a result, I have to rethink a lot of the priorities that I've got. It's not that I'm going out there and being reckless for myself, but it's just sort of like, okay, well, if I'm the caretaker for someone, for a dog that can't take care of herself by herself, I've got to do it for her. So, and I think that makes a difference in how you look at your ride. I'm not out there just sort of like, maybe deciding to ride along a trail and sort of, weave in and out of things and just, sort of, doing my own little crazy weird stuff that I do when I'm riding by myself in my own thoughts. Maybe I'm not listening to a podcast so much or I'm just a lot more focused on, all right, I'm getting from point A to point B. and I'm going to do this in as safe a way as possible. Speed, I definitely ride a lot slower with her. And I think that that all makes sense. And it's all about rethinking those priorities. You know, what am I out here doing? I'm out here having a nice ride, but I'm actually sharing it with someone. I'm sharing it with the dog and she needs extra protection. So that's why I rethink my priorities. So that was number two. Number three, narrow your comfort range when deciding when your tour is a go. I am probably, well, I'm okay with punishing myself to go out on a bike tour. I'm thinking back to the tour that I did a couple seasons ago at the very beginning. I was so ready to go out west and do a ride in the Northwest. And I decided that I was going to do that ride out on the Olympic Peninsula with the Brompton a couple of years ago in the spring. I decided to do it. Was it freaking March? It was either March or April. It was really early in the season. And I knew that I was going to get rained on. And I knew it was going to be cold. But I don't think I was as mentally prepared as what ended up hitting me. I mean, I remember that I was riding in the 40s in rain, which if you've never tackled a cold rain as your touring companion, it was a bit of a suffer fest. It was fun. It was great. But that's the type of thing that I have no problem putting myself through. But there's not a chance that I would ever put my dog through something like that. So when I'm looking at doing a tour and I'm focused on, okay, I want to bring Belle with me, I look for kind of ideal conditions. I have never taken her out when there is a chance of rain. I've never taken her out when the temperatures are too high, and I've never taken her out when the temperatures are too low. And so there's this kind of narrow window of opportunity to be able to take her out. And why is that? It just makes for easier thought processes. I don't have to worry about, okay, well, if she gets wet, then I got to really watch her temperature and, you know, got to be careful about, you know, a wet dog in the tent and all this other kind of stuff. And I know that there's a lot of people who are going out there on grand global adventures with their dogs and they go through the same stuff that you go through. That's fine. That's great. I've got pugs and my dogs just are not built for, you know, the kind of like raw adventures that a lot of the sporting group dogs have. And I think that for a lot of folks with dogs, you know, you're like, this is supposed to be fun. This is going to be something cool. I don't have, you know, some super sporty adventure dog. If you do, great. For me, and I think for a lot of folks who have dogs, they aren't really used to such adventures. They're used to being at home with you and kind of kicking back and eating stuff out of a bowl. And, you know, they're not the wolves that they were descendants of. Many of you have dogs that are very much okay with that. That's cool. For me, I think that narrowing the comfort range is a good thing to do for most dogs. Certainly mine. Pugs are cartoons. They are not adventure seekers. Let's see. Next point is take breaks on a schedule in addition to when you need them. I don't know about you, but I don't exactly look at the clock for anything when I'm out on bike tour. I don't. I guess the only time I do is when I've got ever decreasing amount of light and, you know, I have X amount of hours till sunset. Maybe that's the only time that I'm really cognizant of the time. I drink when I'm thirsty. I eat when I'm hungry. I take breaks when I'm tired. When it comes to going out with the dogs, though, I need to be mindful of the fact that, okay, yeah, she's all curled up in her little crate there on top of my front platform of my bike. But, you know, she is used to going out for walks at certain times. She's used to eating at certain times. Dogs are creatures of habit, way more so than me. You know, I can kind of be like, do I need to eat lunch at like 12:30 or 1:30 or 2 or maybe not at all? You know, I kind of just go with the flow. Dogs, on the other hand, they're very used to their schedule. And you've got to be mindful of that because you're taking them very much out of their comfort zone when you're taking them out on tour. So whatever you can do to keep them in their rhythms, it's a good thing. And you know what? They're not going to be able to ask you, yo, I got to go to the bathroom, or hey, I'm hungry. But generally, you know when they're ready for that kind of stuff. So I would say make sure that you're taking a look at your watch and you're taking breaks on a schedule in addition to when you need them. Next up, expect some deviation in behavior and reaction to food and water. This is through mostly experience with just Belle, but I think that I have heard of similar types of things with other dogs and travel. Again, this goes back to what I was saying before. When you've got a dog and you are changing things up and you're traveling, many of you have gone traveling with your dogs, and so you may have experienced this. Sometimes they're like, what is going on? And, you know, I'll use an example. We've taken Belle to, you know, we've flown her also all over the world. When we've brought her to Paris, I know, boohoo, right? We noticed that she does not like to eat after a long plane ride. And it takes a couple of days to really get her back into the swing of things. On past bike tours, I've never had a problem with that with her. But on one of the ones that I went out on with her just recently, she really turned her nose up to the food. She just was kind of like, you know what? I'm good. I don't really want to eat. And then eventually I was able to get her to eat, but she didn't drink water the entire time we were out there. Now, it wasn't exactly blazing hot or anything like that, but that's unusual for her. And normally I would be, if I was at home, a little concerned and maybe kind of running through some checklists and trying to figure out some things. When I'm on a bike tour, I kind of expect it a little bit, because why? I'm changing what her dynamic is. I'm changing things that she's used to. So she's going to change her behaviors a little bit. So expect some deviation in behavior when you're out on tour. Next up, experiment a lot with your setup and be ready to modify. Actually, I think as I read this, I'm thinking, you know what? I would do this regardless of the dog situation. I'm always looking to experiment with my setup, and I'm ready to modify things just based on what my needs are. I mean, as time has gone on, I think that for those of you who were with the show really early on, you know, my pack list was a very different looking thing. How I packed my bike was a very different thing. You know, now I do this sort of modified bike packing frame bag plus panniers plus whatever setup. And I don't think it's ever the same for any particular tour. It's all dependent on need. So same thing is true with your dog setup. A lot of folks are going to swear by using trailers. A lot of folks will want to have their dogs on their bike if it's possible. I know a lot of folks go with backpacks for their dogs. I have tried all of these things. And ultimately, I found that where I'm at right now is having Belle on the front of the bike gives me all of the things that really create the most comfortable ride for both of us. But what I found, what was interesting on this trip, or these last couple of trips, is I rotated her setup 90 degrees. I didn't have her facing away from the bike, down the trail or back straight at me. I rotated 90 degrees. And what I found is that the weight distribution was substantially better for that setup. And all it was me kind of saying, oh, well, let me try something different and see how it goes. And what was really interesting is I found that from a fatigue standpoint, it was way, way, way better. I wasn't fighting things so much, and I thought it worked really, really well. And how did I stumble upon this thing that allows me to go? I think I could probably do 20 extra miles with her now. Maybe I could do the 60 miles when all is said and done, and you know, we could knock out that whole keep your mileage expectations low thing. How did I come about it? Well, I was just messing around, and that ended up working out. So now that experiment has led to an improved modification for my setup. So I would say go ahead and test things a lot, and experiment and ride a lot. The story that you heard in the best of last week was the original experiment that I had with Louis the pug, right? You know, I thought, oh, great, I'm going to put him in this big, comfortable, you know, crate, and he's going to have his little blanket and a little bed, and he's going to have so much room, and he's going to be really happy. Well, guess what? He was freaking out, as you heard. He just didn't like to be behind me. He wanted to be able to see me, and he just didn't like it. So I went through all the trouble of getting that modified Bob trailer, that faux Bob trailer, and yeah, he was just like, yeah, no thanks. And it turned out putting him in Kimberly's front basket was the way to go. And That's how he liked to bike. That's why I started that way with Belle Starr as well. So experiment, iterate, do it all. Next up, be ready for some wet and dirty paws. All right, I know I just got done saying a couple of notes ago that I go for ideal weather conditions. But when all is said and done, I'm out on the C&O trail with her most frequently. And, you know, it is can be a muddy place in some of those campgrounds. Either, you know, usually I'm not going to be biking during any times where the river's coming out of its banks, but, you know, maybe a couple of days after a rainstorm or, you know, some dew in the grass in the morning or anything along those lines. You've got to be mindful of the fact that you're going to have some grit and you're going to have some wet paws that are going to come in the tent. So what I often try to do is I'll try to intercept her before she goes into the tent, and I'll just wipe off her paws. Just grab her real quick, wipe off all four paws, and then set her inside. And she's usually a good sport about it, although she kind of doesn't care for that kind of manhandling. But hey, it is what it is. And it's good because then things just don't get dirty inside. And I don't know about you, I'm kind of a neat freak when it comes to grit inside the tent. I keep my shoes outside of the tent. I do all sorts of things to try to minimize that so that everything inside is as dry as possible. I think it's just my Virgo OCD part of me or whatever. So be ready for some wet and dirty paws. Solve it however you deem fit. Next up, this is a big one. And this was something that I think I've learned most this year. Maybe I was aware of it, but I think I can finally articulate it. You will not sleep as good as normal until things adjust. I have had one decent night of sleep when I've taken Belle Starr out. I have had mostly mediocre nights of sleep. And part of it is just because when I'm in a tent, I'm used to being alone, quite frankly. And, you know, I can spread out. I can be as comfortable as I want. There's nothing moving inside. There's nothing that's going to startle me or get me up. When I've got Belle in the tent, frankly, she's always moving around. You know, she's adjusting. She needs to get comfortable. So as a result, even though I'm a pretty heavy sleeper once I get to sleep, I find that I don't get a great night of sleep with the dog. Now, when I've taken her out on multiple nights out, which I've done, she will be better on the second night. So be mindful, depending on what your dog's sleeping situation is, that you may not get as much sleep. And of course, if you don't get as much sleep, you're not as well rested. That ends up cascading into the next day with energy levels and all that other kind of stuff. So just be mindful that you're not going to sleep the sleep of champions after the first night necessarily, and factor that in. Last but not least, and I think this is sort of the best piece of advice that I can give to somebody who's thinking about jumping into all of this, and that is, don't jump into big tours immediately. I think that it's really important to go out there and test and iterate and go out on S240s and just make sure that your dog is into bicycle touring. Some dogs thrive in it. Others tolerate it for short stints, and others, well, you heard the Louis story. So, I think that it's really important to know whether your dog is cool with it, is into it. Sometimes these are the things that you really want because you really want to be able to bring your dog and to kind of experience your bike tour and then to be able to kind of cuddle up with your dog in the tent at night. I mean, that's certainly a piece for me. Louis didn't care for it, so I didn't really take him out for any real bike tour. Belle, as it turned out, really, really, really enjoys being with me on tour, and I cannot emphasize enough how much she loves the tent. She could probably take or leave the whole bicycling part of it, but if I just took her out camping, she would do that 10 times out of 10, because for whatever reason, she loves the tent. Every time I set it up, she's like rolling around in it, and once it's set up, very rarely do I have to wonder where she's at. She's usually inside the tent, all curled up and happy as a clam and waiting for me to come to bed. So, you know, that's kind of how things go. I don't think that I would take her out on anything longer than a few days, unless I've taken her out on the C&O for a 2 or 3 day trip, at least a few more times, because I don't know how she would react to a week long trip. I know that she can handle 2 or 3 days. I certainly know she can handle overnights. That's easy. She's definitely done that. But you know what? Before I would get into a longer tour, or before I would commit to something like that, I would make sure that she's done a few 3 day long weekends before I put her through that type of thing. Because, like I said, the small amount of experience that I've had with my personal dogs is, you know what? Sometimes they're into it and sometimes they're not. And if you're thinking, especially with a first time dog, and especially if you're a first time riding with a dog, be really mindful of all of this. I do know that there are folks out there that are great resources for riding with your dog. The number one person that I would encourage you to check out is Jasmine Reese. We've had her on the show a few times, and of course, she's got her dog Fiji with her, and she has gone through all of the iterations on all of this, and she's talked about it a lot on her various platforms. So I would definitely encourage you to check her out. She is fantastic people, and of course, she has forgotten more about touring with a dog than I have ever done. So go check out her stuff. Thanks again for hanging in there, talking about dogs and touring. If you've got any thoughts on all of that, please feel free to reach out. And a quick reminder once again that Pedal Shift Live, December 7th, 3 p.m. Eastern Time, pedalshift.net/live to check that out. And of course, the annual Thanksgiving show drops in a few weeks. I would love to hear from a whole bunch of you. Let me know, what are you thankful about when it comes to bicycle touring? Shoot me a voicemail. That's 202-930-1109, or email pedalshift@pedalshift.net, and I will be reading and playing and enjoying all of the things that you have to say about what you're thankful about on bicycle touring. And as always, we'd like to close out the show with a special shout out to the Pedal Shift Society. Because of support from listeners like you, Pedal Shift is a weekly bicycle touring podcast with a global community, expanding into live shows, meetups, tour journals, you name it. If you like what you hear, you can support the show for $5, $2, or even $1 a month. And there's one shot and annual options if you're not into the whole small monthly thing. Check it all out at pedalshift.net/society. On to the society. Kimberly Wilson, Caleb Jenkinson, Cameron Lien, Andrew MacGregor, Michael Hart, Keith Nagel, Brock Dittus, Thomas Skadow, Marco Lowe, Terrance Manson, Harry Telgadas, Chris Barron, Mark Van Raam, Brad Hipwell, Stuart Buchan, Mr. T, Roxy Arning, Nathan Pulton, Stephen Dickerson, Vince LoGreco, Paul Culbertson, Scott Culbertson, Cody Floerchinger, Tom Beninati, Greg Braithwaite, Sandy Pizzio, Jeff Mustard, Seth Pollock, Joseph Quinn, Drew Porter, Byron Patterson, Joachim Robert, Ray Jackson, Jeff Fry, Kenny Mikey, Lisa Hart, John Denkler, Steve Hankel, Miguel Quinones, Alejandro Avilés-Reyes, Keith Spangler, Greg Towner, Dan Gephardt, Jody Zuranin, Lucas Barwick, Michael Baker, Brian Bechtal, Reinhardt Biggle, Greg Middlemas, Connie Moore, William Gothman, Brian Benton, Joan Churchill, Mike Bender, Rick Weinberg, Billy Crafton, Gary Matuszak, Greg Letoile Lopez, James Sloan, Jonathan Dillard, John Funk, Tom Bilch, Ronald Paroli, Dave Roll, Brian Hafner, Misha LeBlanc, Ari Messinger, and David Grotke. And thanks also to all past and anonymous donors for helping make this show happen. Thank you for joining. You can find Pedal Shift at pedalshift.net for more great bicycle touring content. You can hear the Pedal Shift Project through Apple Podcasts or your favorite podcast app. Opening music courtesy of Jason Kent off his self-titled album. The track is called America. Check out his band Sunfield's latest release, Mono Mono, wherever cool music is available.